welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson, here with Louis Scott-Vargas and special guest this week, Eric Froelich. Hi, guys.
Hello.
Also known as EFRO, or Frodog Millionaire, as the team calls him.
And Rap Dog Millionaire, and Anything Dog Millionaire that you can add to.
Yes, it's a good convention.
That's used by exactly one person in the world.
Now you see where these things spawn from.
Yeah.
Talking a little bit about team today, or the players you guys play with, which may or not be the best in the world, or United States, or wherever you happen to be at the time. We've lost player of the year in the general sense that we used to know it, but recently we've been kind of maybe re-energized for certain people about the World Magic Cup. Whew, it's been a while since I've said it. I didn't want to lose it there. Now, I know you might have changed your travel schedule because of it. Is that true?
Yes and no. Like, I didn't go to Baltimore because I didn't feel like going, but like Seattle, for example, was on the West Coast and it was limited, so, you know, I went there and was happy.
What were the odds of you missing Seattle, really, though?
Very low. Like,
okay.
But, for example, we're both going to Indy, which is of debatable wisdom, but mainly, I think, speaking for both of us, we wanted to play Legacy. We wanted to play with the
right
cards.
If there were, like, three or four Legacy events in the U.S. each year, I'd consider going to different events, but, I mean, if you have to go to Indy, you have to go to Indy. I really want to play the format. I don't get a lot of opportunities. I think it's a lot of fun. Just a good environment.
Well, where would you top out on Legacy events domestically? Would you go to, like, let's say you had four to choose from, two, three? Or would it depend on venue?
It really depends on scheduling. We have other things to do besides Magic sometimes. So, you know, it depends on your conflicts and other things like that. But certainly if anything on the West Coast where there's nothing else going on, there's no way I would miss it. And the fact that I'm flying all the way out to Indy where there's no direct flights from Vegas where I live, it's kind of speaks volumes
too.
And the tickets weren't cheap.
Yeah.
Like, but I mean, it's going to be a good time, so it's worth it.
I mean, where else do you get to play with your beta cards and stuff?
Yeah,
like
exactly.
That? Like, oh, we're using beta duelings of some kind. I have not decided which ones yet.
On the way over here, you had mentioned how you only happen to have three of certain blue combination ones. That sounds unfortunate.
It's true. I don't have the full set yet or anything.
Terribly and getting punished.
I'm no Frodog Millionaire. But
have you ever had to write a deck list down where you're like, I just can't find this fourth volcanic island. I'll just play three. And
No. I don't think I've ever made a card availability decision, but I have, like, it still tilts me to this day in Berlin that I can only find three in my beta land, or else I played three beta and one revised. It's very embarrassing.
That is very embarrassing.
I mean, if you had four, it probably would have helped you, like, I don't know, do a little bit better in that tournament. It's really kind of unfortunate.
It just meant that I was more likely to mulligan the hands with the revised land.
That explains going down 0-2 constantly before coming back.
I just got lucky and didn't draw the elf in the other games. But, I'm like I said, almost a lock to go to any, like, West Coast or even Midwest GP for the most part, like, just because, you know, it's one of the things I like to do. But I feel like this year I get to be a little bit more choosy and not go to all the East Coast ones. And even something like Mexico City, you know, I'm just not planning on going to. But Legacy is a big draw. Like, when they announce the team event, I'm going to go to it.
Right. I had said if they had announced the team event and I'm not too busy and it's in Europe, Japan, wherever, I'm planning on going to that.
Yeah.
Like, it's not something I want to miss.
Yeah.
So minus a World Series weekend, you're going to be there.
Or a World Poker Tour. Any big poker event where I have to fly, you know, very far away, I might consider not going to. But I would consider taking a weekend off the World Series just to go to, like, a West Coast team event. Like, that's just, I just don't want to miss that. I mean, I've already flown to Amsterdam to play Team Grand Prix when it was, like, a more common thing in, like, 2003. So
yeah, teams are just too cool. So,
and I hate flying and traveling. That's how great teams are.
Yeah. But the race for the World Magic Cup and the 16-player player championship both do impact my decisions to some extent. Like, the World Magic Cup race is going to be harder because for me to, or anyone to win that, you have to be in the top U.S., or for any U.S. player to win it, or, you know, the top of your country. For Paulo or Martin, that might be a little easier. But, I mean, Shu has got his work cut out for him. Like, him and Yuya are battling right now. But for me, like, you know, I'm a couple points behind Kibler and only a couple points ahead of Josh and Webb with Matt Costa in the mix as well. And then Conley technically in the running, but
how gracious of you to even put him in there.
Conley's already decided he's not going to go to a bunch of events because he feels like he's far back enough that it's not a huge deal to him and he wants to take some time off.
Well, that's a conversation I had with him last week when we were in Tacoma where it's just like, you know, you don't have time to do normal human stuff.
Well, I mean, because he didn't skip Baltimore, right? And so for those who went to all those events plus Seattle, ever since Hawaii, it's like you get home on Monday, and then on Thursday or Friday you leave for the GP. You get home on Monday. Thursday or Friday, you have 3 days at home, which is like you take a day to get settled in. You have a free day. Then the next day you're already packing.
Depending on how many time zones you've changed. I mean, it's like we were just talking. It's like, oh yeah, I got to register my car this month. I got to, you know, clean my own clothes at some point. Like, these are just regular things you have to find time for. Because he's not going to Indy this weekend.
Yes, this is one of the events he's skipping. And again, the same reason that I felt great about skipping was that skipping one tournament gives you 10 days of being at home instead of three. Like, it gives you just like an additional week that you don't, that's not broken up in any. So like, that's a pretty big deal. And it's pretty great that you get to take those time off and still kind of remain competitive. Like, Kibler so far has gone to most things, but he's also said that he's not going to go to every tournament. Like, the flights to Mexico might not be good enough that he just might not go.
I mean, recently, I think it was this week, he was saying he's skipping Nashville.
Yeah.
Are you guys both going to be in Nashville?
I don't think so.
I wasn't going to, but my experiences at GP Seattle have made me desire to go more than I would have previously. I played against some very interesting opposition, and it kind of lit the fire under. People don't know how to play limited, even less than me, and I don't know how to play limited. Just ask Efro.
He's terrible.
No, but like, seriously, like, when you play against people on Constructed, for the most part, they know what their deck does, and they maybe don't know what your deck does, but like, they could, especially if they pick a deck, like, they don't need to. Like, when I played against Mary Jacobson, she didn't know even what all the cards in my deck did, but she picked a deck, Affinity, which didn't really require her to know that, and she knew how to pilot her deck, and that was enough. She beat me pretty soundly. In Limited, you don't have that luxury. You have to know what all the cards do, and you have to know how to play against them, and just some of my opponents were just not that experienced in playing Limited, especially with Dark Ascension. And I had, you know, it just, some of the matches I played were easier than I thought they were going to be. And I'm not saying I played against all people who were terrible, because I certainly didn't. But I, you know, some of my opponents were just very inexperienced. And like, you know, that makes me a little more likely to go to a sealed GP. Like, normally I'm not a big fan of sealed, but, because sealed is, you know, terrible. But when you play against, you play against a couple opponents who don't really know sealed or the cards as well, it makes me more likely to feel optimistic about making day two, which makes me more likely to want to go to the tournament. Like, I wouldn't play Magic if all the matches were like that, and I had plenty of good matches, but I'm more likely to go to a sealed tournament if I feel that what I open is maybe not as important as it has been in other formats.
And you opened very poorly, correct?
No, I opened very well, so.
Just checking.
Look, I had a Blasphemous Act, Flare of the Hatebound, Huntmaster, Two Fires of Undeath, Brimstone Volley, just a couple cards.
Only X1'd.
I did X1, but I was with a no-show. My round 4 or 5 opponent just didn't show up. And multiple opponents who, like, would play Burden of Guilt on my guy then immediately not tap and have me attack them with it. So it's the sort of thing.
It's a complicated card to play. Does a lot.
You do have to remember it every turn.
Now, speaking with two people that actually kind of have the luxury of picking and choosing which events they want to go to, you could go to the max of whatever that is for each of you. And we talked about this at the announcement of the first leg of this GP season, where it was just huge. You've kind of, you know, ranked it. I mean, there's only one block GP this whole year. We don't know anything about teams. I mean, where do you guys kind of, I mean, Eric, you've already said, you know, if it's a team event, you're going to find a way to get there. Where do you really rank them from? Because it used to be Limited was at the bottom. It's like, oh, there's so many sealed deck GPs. Like, the variance can be so high. I don't really want to go to it. But now, have you guys changed? Is it still just teams far and away and then
teams
everything
are definitely
else?
Definitely far and away. And then Legacy and formats that you can't play as much where you can use some of the cards. Like, I didn't play Magic for a long period of time. From about 2003 to 2010, I barely touched a card. I didn't have Magic online. It wasn't a big part of my life. But, you know, they invited me back on the sponsor's invite, and the game is always something that was a big part of my life, and so it's something I really enjoyed. So I came back to the game, and like, the thing was, growing up, Magic wasn't something that I like really loved. It wasn't something that like I looked forward to playing every day. I liked building decks, but I loved the people. Like, I grew up with John Finkel, Brian Kibler, Ben Rubin, Bob Maher, David Williams. All these guys were like very good friends of mine. And so going to all these events, especially I was in high school and then in college, I was a young kid. I didn't get to go around that much. Like, you get to see all your friends, and no one else really lived near me. And so that was the big draw to Magic more than playing the game. And the game, of course, was great. It's a great game. Everyone knows that. But that wasn't the number one draw for me. And so as those people started to retire, stopped going to events, it became less interesting to me. I didn't dedicate as much time until I was just kind of not really playing. There wasn't a lot of people near me that played. And Magic Online wasn't something that I particularly enjoyed because the game was second nature to the people. So playing online wasn't a huge draw for me. And then when I came back, I started meeting, you know, like Luis and the guys from Channel Fireball. And, you know, a lot of people were, again, very similar to me, which, again, like John and Bob and Dave were all very similar to me, and so you don't find that in a lot of places. And so it's just a great draw, and the game kind of just brings it all together, and it makes you want to go to the events again, and it makes playing the matches and working and testing, all that stuff, more enjoyable. And so, you know, that's what gets me to go to all the events and not necessarily the game. So I try to go to as many events as I can. I go to the events that I think I'll have more fun at, like teams, again, like it's all about the people and your friends, like team event is perfect. Then playing with the cards that I played with 10 years ago, 15 years ago. Like I started playing this game in 1995, maybe 94. And it's like, you know, 18 years ago. So I still have these cards. These are the cards I remember playing with. Like I actually went to one Grand Prix during like the 6 year stretch I wasn't playing. Patrick Chapin, I was living in Detroit, as was he. And he told me about, you know, the new Legacy format, that I could play Brainstorm, Forceful, and Dual Lands. And all we had to do was drive to Chicago, which is like 4 hours away. I'm like, all right, I'll do that. Like, it's the only tournament I played in, like, this six-year block. And so, you know, being able to play Legacy events or Vintage events and things like that is something very interesting to me. I've always considered myself more a limited player, good at drafting, and I think I'm good at evaluating sealed pools. Yeah. And so, one of us is being serious here, but... So that's going to be next on my list. And then Constructed, that isn't, you know, like an Eternal format. Like, I don't enjoy Modern. It's not, like, a lot of the cards just looked oppressive. Like, when I was reading coverage or checking things out and, you know, watching events back in the day, even though I didn't play the standard formats, but didn't really appeal to me that much. Like, current standard, at least, is, you know, rotating around. It's something more interesting to me. And Block, it's kind of a curveball. Some blocks are interesting, some aren't. So I would say, like, Standard, probably Block, and then Modern has just never interested me, I guess.
Well, it's Modern is literally the years you mentioned where it's like you just weren't playing, you weren't interested. I mean, it's, to have to come back and try to pick all of that up in one tournament.
And a lot of the cool cards that I really like that were legal are now banned, so.
Also, Emrakul is an intimidating card, right?
It's extremely rough. So, well, you know, I see all these Lux, like, I'm watching the GP and, like, these guys who clearly are not very good are just, turn three Iona, turn three LHV. It's just like, what? This is really what we're playing?
And you missed Scarsblock, too. Where the Tempered Steel Mirror was the most skill-intensive thing that I can remember, because I went, like, 9-0 in it or whatever, so...
Did I miss Scarsblock? I skipped the Pro Tour, but I think I was playing.
That was Scarsblock, was just the Pro Tour.
Yeah, there was no GP.
Oh, you mean literally the block format. I thought you were because I've skipped all these sets of playing. No. I thought you were like, I wasn't around for Scarsblock. I'm like, Scarsblock. I played that, I think.
You missed one tournament where Luis went undefeated and Constructed, and thusly...
I really wanted to go to that tournament, too, but they put it right in the middle of the World Series, and I had such bad jet lag from Worlds that it took me, like, 2 weeks almost to recover to a normal sleeping schedule when I got back from Chiba that... You know, I was going to go to the event because it turned out the World Series schedule worked out perfectly for me. Like, the 5 days or whatever before the Pro Tour from, like, Wednesday to Monday were, like, very mediocre events that I honestly didn't even care about playing. But then I was worried that I'd have to, like, be taken out, essentially,
right.
for
you
the next 10 days.
A week on either side,
like,
because of it.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking about, like, a high concentration, high mental game that I didn't think I'd be able to play at a very high level.
And then you had to go play Magic.
Lag.
I know what you mean. Jet lag really kills me, too. Yeah.
It makes it so Rob Doherty forgets creatures have first strike, and then Luis casually wins a
match. That did happen in round two, yeah.
I think that might have been a factor in you winning that match and going undefeated.
I was not going to win otherwise. He blocked a 3-3 first strike with a 2-4 and a 2-2, and that did not work out well for him. But
that's tricky.
Well, I mean, it helps explain why, you know, you're not going to miss a Pro Tour event. You're not going to miss a, well, I don't know what we have as far as Worlds goes anymore. But why you're always going to be there is because you can take your little Channel Fireball checklist, all your good friends, and be like, they're all going to be there. And you want to be interacting with that. Where any random GP, Connolly might take one off. Luis, I guess, isn't going to take any more off. But people that lead to...
Not going to Mexico or Salt Lake, so...
Well, there's another weekend. There's an event the weekend of... There's an event week of both of those. You just couldn't be in two places at once.
And there's also something to say of, like, a smaller tournament. The GPs are so big. Yeah. Like, when I grew up, you know, the GPs
were...
Yes, like, the huge GPs, like, 500 people. Where did all these people come up from? Like, day ones were 7 rounds. Now we're looking at potentially 10 rounds. And yeah. It's just
honestly
tough.
The tournaments I've enjoyed least in my life, like if you look at the bottom five, yeah. It's like GP Madrid, GP Paris, like these 1,500, 2,000 plus GPs, because these are the GPs where you can't even see your friends. Your friends are in the tournament and you still don't see them for 6 hours. Like, especially the Euro GPs that split into, like, you know, blue
two
and
groups,
green or whatever.
You can't even, like, match
up. If you're in a different tournament, you're hundreds of feet away from the other person through thousands of people, you don't have time. Like, it's just...
Yeah, for the Magic Weekend in Paris, they had chopped it up into three different areas, too. And they were on different clocks, to the point that, like, people I'm splitting a room with in the same Grand Prix have left an hour before me, even though we're both in day two.
Yeah, it just...
That doesn't add up.
Yeah, so those are less fun. Pro Tours are insanely good. I mean, always. But and they're even going to get better as less people show up.
Well, plus it's just so hard for, like, TOs to manage these Grand Prix. Like, there's so many delays. They go so late. Yeah. There's so many things you can't control. It's not their fault.
No, of
like most
not.
Of the time.
Well, I mean, yeah,
the vast majority.
For the most part, it's
but it's
the
just fact such is, a logistical yeah, nightmare.
When you have 1,500 people trying to play a complicated game like Magic in a tournament setting, and there's time and a bunch of matches go to time, the TO can't do it. The best prepared TO can't you know make the rounds run on time. That's just not possible. So like even when you have like Steve Port, who's like, in my opinion probably one of the best TOs, if not the best, even his events, which are run as smoothly as any event. He still can't make people, you know, finish games in time. Like right. That's not. He can't come on and be like, "You're out." Like,
well, they've done that in European GPs, right? Where like, if you're 0-3, you're out. Third loss and you are dropped.
Yeah, in Madrid, there's no room for you. They just didn't have the space. As soon as you picked up your third loss on day one, you were kicked out of the event. They'd give you a draft set for your troubles, but they canceled all public events on day one and like.
See, this sounds appealing in some ways. I know that so many of the rounds I was watching, it tends to be. I mean, you don't want to say anything about the players who aren't doing as well, but, you know, those tend to be the matches that actually go longer because you have less experienced players and you have people who are just playing the game for fun, and that's great that, you know, they're able to do that, and I encourage that for sure, but at the same time, like, it makes the events go a lot longer, and so it's just a hard thing to run, and so...
Yeah, well, then you have, you know, Martin Jouza in events in Tom Martel, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know if they've ever finished a round on time, but...
Well, it's tough.
Yeah.
There's so many decisions. What land are you going to play turn one? It's two different pictures on this island.
It's gonna be difficult because as TOs, you know, if Grand Prix are the only avenue they have to run events in the future, whether it be now or a year from now, I could see them moving to conventions and trying to draw in more people and those fields becoming larger. It could be something where we see something like Madrid, where it's like the Grand Prix main event could become something more similar to a Pro Tour, versus like, well, we want you to play Magic. Let's find another way for you to do it. If you get a certain number of losses, like, let's keep this tournament going. Because, you know, 2,000 people in a domestic Grand Prix is not unreasonable, in my opinion.
I mean, if it's good for Magic, it's good for Magic, and I want it to be good for Magic, and whatever is the best, you know, is good, and I like that people enjoy going to the tournaments. I'm just saying on a personal level, I'm less inclined to go. If I knew for a fact that, like, Nashville is going to be over 2,000 people, that would really slant me heavily towards not going. And, like, you know, the fact that Seattle wasn't that big was great. Like, it just is less fun and less enjoyable and makes me want to go to tournaments less when they're this huge. I'm not saying they should turn away people or anything like that. I'm just saying, like, it disincentivizes me.
Well, it definitely feels like you're dodging attendance going all the way to Australia, not going to Salt Lake City.
Well, I actually made a habit of going to the Australian. You know, I went to the last two Australian and the last New Zealand Grand Prix, like the one they have every year, the last 3 years. And the fact that I was invited to go out there this time, you know, made me pretty happy. Like, I want to go to it. Like, it's a fun tournament, and it's going to be small. It's like the Australian GPs is like actually one of the last old GPs here. You get to play in a 400-person Grand Prix. It's awesome.
Cakewalk.
I mean, I'm not going to say that. It's not like I've done well at every time, you know. Like, I'm no Jeremy.
I mean, it's limited, so. He's not going to be one of the better players in the room.
Oh, the jokes.
I was just kidding when he says I'm bad at limited.
So, where are the jokes?
Yeah.
So, we're nearing the end of this first trimester of Grand Prix. I know, I can't
trimester.
Get away. We're
almost ready. It's coming.
3-4 months ago, we looked at this schedule. We were like, is it going to be the whole year like this? How are players going to do it? How many Road Warriors have really come out and are not missing a single event, really?
Shuhei is really the only person I can think of. Like, he's the one who, like, went to, you know, all the USGPs before Hawaii, didn't go to Nebraska, went back and played in Kobe, and then came back for Baltimore, and then Seattle, and then Indianapolis, and then Nashville, and then Mexico City, and then Salt Lake City.
Yeah, I mean, I don't get it. At the same time, like, it's great that people are able to enjoy Magic to that level and try to qualify for all these great things and achieve the clubs that they obviously is already more than locked for, these platinum clubs and things like that. But, you know, it's great that people have that option. At the same time, it's great that people can take the time off, that you can be like Conley and take this GP off. You don't think it's, you know, going to be your best event. You've played so many tournaments in a row. At the same time, like, Magic is for fun. Like, it's a lot of people's careers now at this point, which is great. But it's, if you're not having fun, then what's the point? Why are you playing this game? And so take the weekend off, come back the next one, you're fine.
I can only imagine Shuhei loves it, you know, if he's going to all these things. And so he's not wrong to do that. But on the other hand, you don't want to end up getting to a point where you just like feel like you're dragging yourself to event after event. And like, for example, Paulo, his initial plan was to come out and play at all the GPs through Mexico City and then head home. And he stayed with me for some time. He stayed with like a bunch of other people. And after getting second on the Pro Tour and then doing well enough and like top eight in Orlando, he realized he had enough points. He was locked for platinum. He had enough points that no one's catching him in Latin America, especially since
he got the banana. He got a banana this big.
Especially since the second place guy in Latin America got suspended for 2 years for who knows what.
It's highly surprising.
All I know is Paulo was pumping the fist. But so he's locked for everything, and he realized I can just go home. And he decided that was his best move. He didn't want to skip school if he didn't have to. And it's great that he gets that choice, that he can just skip five events in a row and not be harmed by it.
Now, are you going to rest up in that kind of second trimester because you don't have to do as much traveling? There aren't as many domestic events.
Only if you stop using the word trimester.
At this point, I've looped the spectrum. I wasn't too happy about it at first. We did that entire episode talking about the Grand Prix schedule. It's like, let's just run with it. So by the time the third trimester runs around for you,
supposed to run in your second trimester.
Yeah, when's your push day?
Yeah, seems unsafe.
Are you going to be? Will they let you back on the plane for that third trimester so that you can get to all these?
Like Yifro said, it depends on what formats they are. Like, I guess if you were to do my ranking, it looks kind of the same. Team here, Legacy, like significantly far down, but still pretty good. And then probably actually. Like Modern. I actually like Modern because I still play Urza's Tower.
Yeah. So polar opposites. Didn't play 03 to 010. Didn't do anything but eat burritos and play Magic from like 04 to 010.
It's true. The first Pro Tour was 04 and then,
I think there are some puns in there somewhere. Not sure. Yeah. Somewhere in 05.
Yeah.
I think there's a pun phase.
And then after Modern, I like Limited and then Standard's like significantly lower. Like, I mean...
Block, not even on the radar.
I like Block generally, but
hard to judge Block because
it's unique, it's swingy, it could be it could be 10 decks, it could be 2 decks.
Yeah. Right. So, like, I loved on, like,
if you're going to play Rebel Block, you're playing Rebels or you're playing Rising Waters. Like, this is not very fun. Like, I mean, this is the Block that I remember, so sorry it was 12 years ago. But
conveniently, you didn't play much after that.
Well, the first Block PTQ I ever played in was a Onslaught Block PTQ, and it was great. I thought it was a lot of fun. I got to play these glacial blue-white decks with all sorts of, like, nonsense decrees of blue is and white. So
yeah,
we played in that PTQ.
It doesn't come up very often.
No. The fact that TSG stifled a Flooded Strand in a matchup where only Decree of Justice matters is not relevant in the slightest. But
trying to get the edge in game one, whatever, it doesn't matter.
There's value. You're not just going to leave it on the table.
Yeah, of course. But yeah, I mean, so when we look at the next phase, next couple months of GPs,
sure, call it what you will.
Yes,
we all know what they are.
I'm going to look at, what the formats are. Come hell or high water, going to the team one. Probably going to any Legacy one I can. I probably wouldn't travel to Europe for a Legacy GP just because, going to Europe is just a huge time commitment and the Legacy scene
is so
big. They
get 2,000 people.
Yeah, they get 20. Like, I did that for Madrid and just regretted it immensely. I also played Enchantress, which I also regretted immensely. But no one ever said I was smart, so.
Literally
you can't leave the audience with a bit of a spoiler. I mean, who's the team? You're going, right?
Oh, besides Paulo, I actually don't know who my third is.
You know Webb's sitting right over there, right? He's...
Is he? I couldn't tell because only the inter...
I thought that was a token.
Yeah, I thought it was just a life-size token propped up on the wall. But, I mean, both Paulo and I have veto power, so we actually have to agree on someone, so... It also, I suppose, would depend on the format, too. I mean...
If it's limited, it's very different than who they'd have to play with Constructed, because...
Ben Stark?
It would have to be someone who carries him. No, if it's... It depends on which limited format it is. Like, they're talking about being booster draft. If it's Rochester draft, then you don't want Ben Stark.
Yeah.
But,
there's Rochester draft, no one wants to play, so it's no big deal.
Except all
the I would pros. Do anything, yeah.
I would go to Europe for a Rochester.
I would cut off my left arm.
So a domestic Rochester draft Grand Prix might only get 400 players.
That would also be good.
But it's not true. Everyone, people are still going to want to check it out. Like, they haven't had this opportunity to do it.
And it's team sealed day one. Everyone loves that.
Yeah, of course.
But, so yeah, it's going to depend on the formats, what tournaments I go to. It's going to depend on my personal schedule. It's going to depend on how I feel, what I feel like. Also, almost any tournament on the West Coast I'm just going to go to because the flights are so cheap and so short. And it's direct. A direct flight versus a non-direct flight is just a world of difference. And if it's on the East Coast, like, again, Baltimore, East Coast Standard GP, right in the middle of a bunch of tournaments. It was not a hard decision to skip. Whereas you're looking at Nashville, which is like pretty much East Coast, but limited, and you know, I feel more inclined to go than I would have otherwise. So, again,
and the hotel has a bacon sampler. So.
It does. The Grand Ole Opryland. Last time we were there, it's just literally just three types of bacon, two strips of each, and then Matt Ness lost the game. So it was.
It's a bacon free roll.
It was a bacon free roll. Our table only got like five bacon samplers, though.
Oh, that's not so bad.
Yeah.
And you're not going to this event?
I've been to it.
All right.
Been there, done that. I'll be back.
The last GP where that was the impressive one where Rietzel 10-0 no cashed.
Yeah, that was incredible.
Yeah. So,
I mean, it really comes down to flights. If there's a good flight, like, I value my time very highly, and my time sitting on a plane is a very valuable commodity and not something I like to do very often. Mm-hmm. So I need to be incentivized quite a bit to do that.
Is there no kayak search option for has to have Wi-Fi? Is that
well, I mean, just anything that I'm forced to take a layover is something that I have to really want to be doing.
Yeah.
Like, it's just not something I do very often and not an option I consider to be, you know, something I want to consider very often at all, I guess. Good for you.
Ben S. has repeatedly said he would pay $100,000 to be able to sleep. Like,
to be fair, he said he'd pay $1 million to have a Chick-fil-A sandwich noon every day.
Yeah, he has. Ben S. is the one who originated the, how much do you tip on $1 million steak?
Said it would be the normal $20.
Yeah.
More of this coming to a local Grand Prix near you.
Yeah.
But maybe not Nashville.
So. Yeah, we'll see.
Definitely Indy, because we already booked.
Yes.
Stay tuned.
Thanks for watching.